The idea behind sensor fusion is that we take that we estimate the state of a dynamic system by taking measurements from two or more independent measurement systems that both have their, or that all of them have their pros and cons, and then we combine them in a clever way so that the final result of these combined measurements has better quality than either of the measurements taken by itself. So concretely, now we are looking here at the problem of the dynamic system of tracking an object in this case 2D space. So we have this object moving along this trajectory. You can also see it's rotating. Down here we have the graph of rotation over time. Starts at zero, goes up, goes down. Ignore this discontinuity here. That's just the angle wrapping from minus 180 to plus 180. But either way, we have this moving object, and now we want to track it over time. So for sensor fusion, we want to use two different ways of doing this. And the first one we are looking at is going to be some external absolute position measurement system. That can be a camera or a set of cameras or spinning lasers or something electromagnetic, it doesn't really matter. What all of those systems have in common is that they directly measure position and, in this case, orientation as well. So if you look at this a bit more closely, those yellow dots are the measurements we take, then you notice that we have quite a bit of noise in there. These are real measurements, so they're never perfect. You always have some noise. So if I iterate the simulation here over time, you can see how these yellow measurement points jump around randomly around the ideal theoretical trajectory, this gray curve. So the other issue is that not only do we have noise, but these measurements are point measurements. So between two of these measurement points, we don't know anything about the object, how it behaves between here and there. So let's say you want to drive a head tracking system and you need to generate a VR frame at this point in time. What head position do you use to generate that frame? You can't use this one because that's still in the future and you don't have a crystal ball. So you have to use stuff that is in the past. And no matter whether you use this one here directly or use some kind of interpolation based on, let's say, creating a spline from several older measurements, if there's any unpredictable change to the state of the object between the last measurement and the time where you need it, that is never going to be represented, meaning that the measurement that you take is, at worst, exactly as old as the update rate, which in this case is 33 milliseconds, because these external systems typically don't have very high update rates. And so you have a worst-case latency of automatically 33 milliseconds in this particular case. And that is not particularly good. But the upside of the system is that we do make a continuous error in these measurements. That's the jitter that we have in all of these measurements. And I should mention the jitter gets especially noticeable if you have a part in the object's trajectory where it's coming to rest for a bit, like up here, and you see how wildly these things are, how they jump around between iterations, meaning how unconstrained they are. But the upside is that the amount of deviation between the measurements and the real positions doesn't change over time, meaning it doesn't matter if we track the objects for 17 seconds, as in this simulation, or for 10 hours. The quality of measurement after 10 hours is exactly going to be the same as the quality at the very beginning. So that's a plus on this particular end. But if you were to use these measurements directly for head-tracked VR, it just would be a very unpleasant experience. You would get, well, probably a bit nauseated, and definitely very much annoyed. The image would be jumping around a lot, not just because the position measurements are noisy, but of course the same holds for the orientation measurements, which are for head-mounted VR actually the bigger deal there. So this means that using these data directly for head tracking is not good. I tried that using a very good optical tracking system. It still did not work at all because, to wrap it up, we have a system that has quite a bit of noise, that has low update rate and therefore high latency, but on the other hand, the quality of the measurements doesn't change over time. So now we want to fuse this with another type of measurement, and in this case we are using an inertial measurement unit, an IMU, that is attached to the object being tracked. So an IMU is a combination of accelerometers and gyroscopes. The accelerometers measure, well, acceleration. This red curve here is the acceleration in x direction over time, and the bluish curve is the acceleration in y direction over time. And down here, this yellow curve is angular velocity measured by a gyroscope over time. Again, these are real sensors, or at least simulated real sensors, so they have noise. If you zoom in here, you see this gray curve is the theoretical angular velocity of the system, and the yellow dots are the measurements. So the question is now, if you have measurements of acceleration and angular velocity, how do you get from that to estimates of orientation and position? And the process by which you do that is called dead reckoning. The idea is actually quite simple. You start out from a known state, from some position that was measured at some point, so it still is not absolutely perfect, it has some noise to it, a measurement of orientation, this yellow dot down here, and then you move through time as more data comes in from your IMU by integrating the measurements at each step. So what that means is, how do you go from, let's say, angular velocity to orientation? You have to integrate it once, and that gives you this curve here. And how do you go from acceleration to position? You have to integrate it twice. First you go from acceleration to velocity, and then you go from velocity to position, and this is the result that you get. So let's have a look at this here, a bit more closer look at this, and it looks very different from the measurements that we had before. For one, there's no visible noise. These curves are smooth as can be, and that is a first fundamental difference. Why are they so smooth, even though we have these quite noisy measurements? And the reason for that is that integration acts as a low-pass filter, meaning it removes noise. And especially if you double integrate, then of course there's even more noise removed, which is why this is so smooth. The other fact of this is that IMUs typically have a higher update rate than those external systems that are being used. The external system we were looking at earlier had a 30 Hz update rate. This IMU here has a 1000 Hz update rate, which is actually realistic. And that is the update rate of the IMUs in both the Oculus Rift and the HTC Vive. So the higher update rate also means that we have a low worst case latency. If I take one measurement every millisecond, then no matter when I look, I always have a measurement that is less than 1 millisecond old. So that's great. But on the downside, if you look at this trajectory here, you notice that even though there's very little or no noise, the discrepancy between the red and the gray curve changes over time, meaning that the measurement is drifting. And why is it drifting? The fact is that we are integrating noisy measurements, I mentioned that, and while integration acts as a low-pass filter, it's not for free. You get rid of noise, but what you get in return is drift, because these errors that you integrate, they accumulate over time. So if you look at this orientation measurement, you see that the drift there is really almost invisible. It starts out almost perfect at the beginning, and then here, almost 10 or so seconds down the line, the discrepancy is still so small that I have to zoom in all the way to even see it. And that is because we're integrating once to go from angular velocity to orientation. And if you integrate once, then the error you're accumulating grows in a linear fashion, meaning that if you integrate for twice as long, the error is going to be twice as bad. So it doesn't grow all that much over this relatively short time frame, to reiterate that 17 seconds from here to there. On the other hand, you see that the position estimate looks worse, and that is because I have to integrate twice. Integrating once gives me linear error buildup, integrating twice gives me quadratic error buildup. What that means is, if I integrate for twice as long, my error is now going to be four times as big. And that is a whole other way of growing, meaning that the noise, that the drift builds up much more quickly. But if you look at this, you might say, well, gee, it's actually not that bad, right? I'm integrating over 17 seconds, and the distance here between the theoretical and the real, or the simulated, is really quite small. And if I iterate these measurements, you notice that yes, it jitters, but it doesn't jitter by all that much. But there is a dirty secret there, and that is, if you look at the control dialog over here, it says zero for gravity, meaning I'm essentially simulating this in outer space. The moment I take this back to Earth, where any object is undergoing a constant acceleration of 9.81 meters per second squared upwards, things suddenly look a lot different. You notice that now there's quite a bit of difference, and if I iterate this, you'll see that the measurement is really going all over the place. I should mention that what's the scale here, from here to there, is I think about 5 meters, so here from there to there. After 17 seconds of tracking, the estimated position of my object is more than 5 meters off from where it should be, which of course makes this completely impractical for any tracking applications. If you want to see it in more detail, I made a video a couple years ago where I show this for a real IMU, and I show how quickly the noise builds up. So why is gravity such a problem for dead reckoning? And for that we have to go back and look at the accelerometers. And what's happening here is that I mentioned any object in a gravitational field undergoes a constant acceleration, in the Earth's case 9.81 meters per second squared, which is a pretty large acceleration. So if you want to integrate those measurements, because the accelerometers that are going along with the object measure that extra acceleration, I have to subtract that out again. I have to cancel it out before I can integrate. The problem here is that the accelerometers are attached to the object, so they rotate with the object as it rotates, meaning that at some point when the orientation of the object is 0 degrees, like here, then the gravity acceleration will pull straight up, straight in the positive y direction. But if I have sometimes later on I have an angle of 90 degrees, then now suddenly gravity will pull in the x direction. So in order to cancel out gravity, I have to know the current direction of the gravity vector in the object's body coordinate system, meaning I have to know the precise orientation of the object at any time. But orientation is another estimated measurement that is drifty and noisy, meaning that I can never exactly get rid of gravity. And given that gravity is a fairly large acceleration, that is really messing up my day here. And that is why IMU-only tracking is not feasible, because we don't know how to get rid of gravity. Okay, so enough of that. So now what happens if I start fusing these two different measurements, the one from the external system and the one from the IMU, and the result looks like this. We still have these yellow measurements, which still have the same amount of noise as before, and the red curve is still the final result of tracking the estimated position and orientation of the object. But if you now zoom in, you notice that it looks quite different, in that it now has a lot less noise than before. It is much better quality. It doesn't jump from measurement to measurement like here, but instead it is sort of averaging over all of the measurements I take, and that is exactly the secret here. I don't want to go into too much detail on the algorithm I'm using, which is a so-called uncentered Kalman filter. There are probably thousands of books written on the subject, but suffice it to say that this algorithm really gives us the best of both worlds. It gives us relatively no noise. There's still noise, and you notice that the noise also looks quite different. There are these stretches where there is no noise at all from here to there. These are the stretches between subsequent measurements of the external system. This is where the tracking is driven entirely by dead reckoning based on accelerometers and gyros, which, as I mentioned, have very, very low noise, integrated noise. And then a new measurement comes in, and now the current estimate jumps. But unlike in the first case, it doesn't jump directly to a measurement, which is noisy, but it just jumps slightly in the direction of a measurement. And that is the magic here, that the sensor fusion algorithm keeps track of how much weight it should give to the measurements coming in, meaning that it will not have the same noise, it will have significantly reduced noise compared to the raw measurements from the external system. So that takes care of noise. In terms of latency and update rate, tracking is still primarily driven by the IMU. So this is all pretty flat, but if you look at a narrow curve here, you'll see that these segments, these curve segments between external updates, are not straight lines, they are curved, meaning that any sudden motion that happens between external updates would be represented in the tracking data, meaning that the effective latency of the tracking data is determined by the IMU update rate, not by the external system update rate. So in this case, the worst case latency of any measurements we have is on the order of 1 millisecond, meaning we get the good update rate. And if you look at this, if you look at this trajectory here, we see that there is no drift. The measurements at the beginning of the tracking sequence are more or less as good as the ones at the end. If you look more closely, you'll find out they're even better. Let me zoom in here at the very beginning. You notice that there's a lot of jumpiness here. That's because the filter has to start out, it has to initialize itself. It has to estimate some unknown things about the system, and that's why it's jumping around a lot. But then these estimates converge towards the true values, and then we are getting very good tracking over time. So we have now a joint system that has the low noise that is somewhere between the noise we get from dead reckoning and from the external system, but it's much smaller than the external system's noise. We have the high update rate and low worst case latency of IMU-based dead reckoning, and we have no drift. So this is basically, yeah, the best of both worlds, and this makes this a practical VR head tracking system. And it's of course no secret that this is exactly the algorithm that is used by all the commercial VR headsets. Oculus Rift has its Constellation system, which is sensor fusion between an IMU and a set of cameras. HTC Vive has its Lighthouse system, which is sensor fusion between an IMU and sets of spinning lasers. And PlayStation VR has sensor fusion between an IMU and an external stereo camera, in the case of the PS4 eye camera. But the bottom line is that all of these systems are not practically useful, and that is one of the reasons why now VR is finally working, because until very recently we didn't have cheap, high quality, low noise, and small and lightweight accelerometers and gyroscopes. We now have these microelectric mechanical systems that are essentially integrated into chips and can just be put into controllers, headsets, what have you, and who are which are good enough to give us this kind of result. So one point I want to make is that when there are discussions about the pros and cons of different systems, a lot of people latch onto the fact, let's say they put a lot of weight onto the quality of the external system, the cameras or the lasers. They say, oh, one system might have a 30 hertz update rate, another system might have a 60 hertz update rate. That means the second system is twice as good or has twice the latency, but that is not true. The important thing is that in the sensor fusion result, the tracking result is driven not by the external system but by the IMU. The external system is merely used to correct for drift. What that means in practice is that the update rate and the quality is primarily determined by the IMU. To give you an example, let us set the update rate of the external system to something fairly low, let's say to 0.1 seconds, meaning 10 hertz, and you'll notice that the result is still basically the same. Didn't really change all that much. There's maybe a little bit more noise. You can see there's a bit more drift build up here, but overall it is still fairly low noise. It is still in low noise and still has the same latency of the IMU system, even though we have a 10 hertz update rate. Let's take this to the extreme and set the update rate to 1 hertz, which of course is utterly unrealistic. Oops, I'm pressing the wrong button here. Oh, hang on. There we go. So now we see that there is now drift buildup because the update rate is so low that here we start with a very good approximation and we deviate from the curve and we snap back. But again, the noise is now higher than it used to be, but the responsiveness of the system is pretty much the same as it was before. And of course, 1 second, 1 hertz update rate is a ridiculous notion. Let's set this back to, again, I pressed the wrong button, this is ridiculous. The update rate is, let's set this back to, whoops, let's say 50 hertz, okay. My point being here that when you compare different sensor fused tracking systems, the quality, the noise level, and especially the update rate and latency of the external system is a relatively poor measurement of tracking quality, which is why Oculus Rift is getting away with a 60 hertz update rate, and why the Vive's update rate is basically also 60 hertz. It's 120 hertz, but it's interlaced, so yeah, well, you know, it comes out to the same. Six one way, half a dozen the other. All right, so before I close, I want to point out something else that I found rather, well, mind-blowing when I started implementing this. Hang on, before I go on, if you want to see more of this, if you want to find out about this in more detail, and especially if you want to see the results of sensor fusion from a real tracking system, I made another couple of videos a while ago where I analyzed results from the HTC Vive's Lighthouse system, where you can see this exact behavior that we are simulating here in reality, where you have these stretches of prediction data followed by a small update and then another stretch of prediction data and so forth. The only difference being that because it's real data, we don't know what the theoretical result should be, and we are not seeing the raw update measurements because you only see the fused results. But if you compare these simulations to those real data, you'll see that they are basically the same, meaning that this simulation here is fairly realistic in its representation how that works. I just wanted to make that point. Okay, so now to the other thing. I mentioned PlayStation VR earlier, and one question that I've been fielding a lot over the last couple of years is how in the world can PlayStation VR track the position and orientation of its PlayStation Move controllers? Because if you think about it, a PlayStation Move controller is a glowing ball with a handle attached, and as it turns out, tracking the position in 3D of a glowing ball using a single camera or a stereo camera is very easy. It's not very easy, but you can track it very accurately. I made a video about that, I don't know, a couple of years ago. But by virtue of it being a glowing ball, it looks the same from any angle. So the camera system that is used for tracking can never directly measure the orientation of the controller. So how can you estimate that orientation based on that if all you have are position and a built-in IMU? And I always had the hunch that it works, because obviously it works, but I really couldn't really explain very well how it works, and I couldn't make a very good case for it being the result of sensor fusion. So now that I have this simulation here, we can simply try that. I have a button here that can turn off position measurements, and then we can see what happens. So what we're hoping is that even though I turn off the direct measurement of orientation, that the sensor fusion will still give us at least a very rough estimate of what the orientation of the tracked object is. So without further ado, I'm going to turn this off, and ta-da, I lied. It is not a very rough estimate, it is an extremely good estimate. Let's have a look at this. At the beginning of the simulation, my estimate is rather poor. The reason being that I never measure the orientation, so I have to guess it. And as it turns out, my guess was very wrong. I guessed that the initial orientation would be 90 degrees, but it's really 0 degrees, so I'm off by 90 degrees. And you would assume that that would be fatal, but it turns out that over a very short amount of time, less than 1 second, this vertical notches here, 1 second apart, my very bad initial guess suddenly converged to the actual orientation measurement. You can see how it gets corrected every time a new camera measurement comes in. And I want to reiterate that these camera measurements only measure position, they do not measure orientation. But we still nonetheless converge to the real orientation, and then once we converge, we are going to stay there. And as we go through time here, you can see how small the deviation is between my complete out of thin air orientation measurement, orientation estimate, and the theoretically ideal orientation. So how does this work? What kind of black magic is that? And it turns out it's not black magic. It is based purely on the mathematical properties of this particular sensor fusion filter, which is of course the reason why it is a vastly popular filter. So how can we estimate the orientation of an object if you never measure it directly? And the answer, of course, lies in the accelerometers and gyroscopes, specifically in the accelerometer. I mentioned earlier that the accelerometers are attached to the tracked object, so they rotate along with the tracked object. So imagine now that you have a stretch in your tracking data where your accelerometers tell you that there's a constant acceleration along, let's say, the positive x-axis. But at the same time, your camera measurements or your absolute position measurements tell you that there's a motion along, say, the positive y-axis. And based on that, you can deduce that the orientation estimate of the object that you had was off by about 90 degrees, because you were supposed to measure acceleration along y. You did measure acceleration along x, so that means that x and y had changed places, meaning you were rotated wrong by 90 degrees. And as it turns out, that is exactly what is happening here. Initially, my orientation is way off, and now between the time until I get the next update, meaning those, in this case, I have 50 Hertz update rate, so I'm getting 20 measurements between here and there from the IMU, it measures a certain acceleration in some direction, and then the next camera measurement comes in and says, nope, you didn't go in the direction you thought, you go into a different direction, and then the algorithm internally updates the orientation, and it keeps doing that as more data comes in. It can't do it in one step because the position measurements are rather noisy, but over if you accumulate enough measurements, and in this case I'm accumulating 50, which is really not that much, bam, you zero in right on that. Now, this is great news if you want to track a glowing ball, which is great news for PSVR, of course, but what really blew me away is that the rationale that I just explained, how you compare the predicted motion from the accelerometer to the measured motion from the camera, and then based on that you say, oh, my orientation estimate must have been wrong, I never programmed that in. The only thing I changed between this version of the algorithm that we've been talking about the entire time and this one is that I no longer measure orientation. Everything else stayed the same, which means that the sensor fusion code figured out how to correct orientation measurements based on accelerometer readings by itself. I'm not trying to say that this is some kind of computer learning or artificial intelligence algorithm. It is purely based on the mathematical description of the tracked system, meaning an object moving under acceleration and angular velocity, that directly led to the algorithm mathematically being able to deduce and derive how to correct the initial very wrong orientation estimate. And as I said, that is one of the reasons why this particular filter, or I should say this particular family of filters, the Kalman filters, are so extremely popular in any kind of application where you have to estimate the state of a dynamic system, meaning something that moves, based only on partial and noisy measurements. The Kalman filter is what took Apollo to the moon, what took the Mars rover to Mars, what is driving around the Mars rover on Mars, which is measuring the position of submerged submarines, and as it turns out, is tracking the heads of people in VR. And on that note, I want to end. Thank you very much for watching this very long and hopefully not too boring video, and see you next time.